Y'all ready for this? Welcome to Sports Kid Drama Kid. I'm Jim. I'm the Sports Kid.
I'm Andy. I'm the Drama Kid.
And if you'd like to support our show, you can do that on Patreon now.
We have a Patreon now.
Patreon.com/SKDKpod.
Yeah. Tell friends, write a review, or just give stars. You don't have to write anything if you don't want to. Yeah. Follow us on TikTok and Instagram.
So, Andy, we're going back to basketball today for a story that is kind of about basketball and kind of about rich guys and money and stuff again.
You know, I'm sensing a theme in sports. There seems to be a really large overlap between sports and rich guys with money.
Oh, yeah. They love it. They love to buy sports teams, go to sports games, bet on sports, all the above.
Well, I feel like, I'm assuming owning a sports team is a sign that you've like
made it
financially.
If you have like billions of dollars and you couldn't want for anything that like money could buy, a sports team is something that not everyone
has. It's like the main way to dispose of your disposable income. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So we're going to talk about sort of that behind the scenes basketball debating and backroom dealing today a little bit.
Okay.
But before that, I'm going to go back to 1966.
Okay.
The year the Beatles put out Revolver.
Oh, wow.
The Beach Boys released Pet Sounds.
Oh, my gosh.
And the Doors broke on through with their popular self-titled record. The reefer was plentiful and chill. The Vietnam protests were also plentiful, but not nearly
not
as chill.
Not chill.
Angela Lansbury took home the Tony Award for Best Actress in a Musical for Mame.
Oh, I need to give a moment to Mame because it is one of the most ridiculous musicals of all time, but so fun.
Okay, I'll have to learn about more about it.
This is controversial, but I prefer the Lucille Ball movie version of Mame. She can't sing a lick, but she's very, very funny in it. And I love that Angela Lansbury won the Tony Award for it because it's a ridiculous show.
Man of La Mancha won the award for Best Musical. Any thoughts on that?
I agree with that take. I love Man of La Mancha. It has one of the most beautiful songs ever written for a musical of all time, The Impossible Dream. It's a gorgeous song. Gorgeous song.
Across the country from Broadway, in the world of basketball, the NBA was looking to expand from 10 teams to 12 teams.
There were only 10. Oh my goodness.
Which they would do by adding teams in San Diego, California, and Seattle, Washington.
Okay.
The San Diego expansion team was named the Rockets, after a city always in motion, and one that helped develop the Atlas missile program.
That makes more sense than a city always in motion.
In 1971, these same Rockets would move to Houston, where their name would fit even better with the city's space industry and aerospace culture. Up the West Coast in Seattle, the second new franchise would also be named after a new development in loud airborne technology. This team was dubbed the Supersonics. Often referred to as just the Sonics, the Supersonics got their name from Seattle's ties to the aviation industry. Specifically, the contract won by their Boeing factory to develop a supersonic transport jet.
Huh. I did not know that.
This plane was seen as the next step in travel. Faster than the speed of sound, it promised a world where businessmen could smoke Newports from Broadway to Bellevue, Washington, and get there before they finished a whole pack.
Did this jet end up happening?
In 1971, the supersonic jet program was phased out due to environmental concerns and noise pollution concerns from, you know, the sonic booms.
I was about to say, you're describing this, and I was like, we don't have that as far as I know.
I actually looked it up, and they're working on a new one.
Of course they are. Aren't they also working on like a bullet train or something?
I don't know.
Is it called a bullet train, or is that just the name of the movie with Brad Pitt in it that I saw a bunch of ads for?
That is on Netflix. We have not watched it.
But is that like a high-speed train?
Yes, it's a bullet train. I think they have them in Asia.
Okay.
One quick side note, I love this old trend of naming sports teams after technological advances and engineering contracts won by the home city. I'm excited for the next round of NBA expansion when we get the San Jose Adobe Creative Clouds, whose mascot is just an ad for Adobe Express Premium. And the other team, the North Carolina Bulletproof Vests, whose mascot is Kevlar Kevin.
Oh my God, that's dark. My brain was going in the direction of, like, I don't know, what's a city that starts with an A? The Albuquerque Amazon Warehouses.
also a team that we're adding. We're adding three. We're going to need a fourth just to round out the evenness there.
I mean, I think what's funny about this is, like, the Sonics literally, like, hitched their star to something that didn't end up happening. So I would love if there had been a team that was, like, named after, like, the iPod Nano.
Yeah. Yes. The Nantucket Nanos. While the San Diego team moved to Houston, the Sonics were there to stay despite the jet that they were named after being phased out.
Mm-hmm.
And they became the first major league sports team that the city of Seattle ever had.
They didn't have the Seahawks or the
Mariners? Not yet.
Huh. I want to tell you, the reason I'm so familiar with the Seattle sports teams, do you know?
Is because you stayed there a couple times for work.
No, I was going to say because of Frasier. Yeah, I went there for work, but, like, I didn't, that didn't, you know.
I thought you might have picked that up.
No.
Okay.
It's because they get mentioned on Frasier a lot, because one of the main recurring, you know, plot points of Frasier is that Frasier and Niles, his brother, are very into, like, opera and the arts and wine and, like, very snobby things. But their father is very into, like, light beer and sports, and he loves the Mariners, and he does mention the Sonics. I think they go to a Sonics game in one episode.
They must have sold too many tickets. They've stuck us in these folding chairs.
Wow, right on the hardwood, 5 feet from the baseline.
It's like front row orchestra, stage right.
Oh, man, we're so close, we're gonna hear teeth rattle when they set a pick.
It's like sitting close enough to get hit by Placido Domingo's spades.
The end of the shoot-around. The coach is about to send the starting five in for the tip-off.
The stage manager just called places.
Well, that's really funny that that's how you know the Sonics. Mm-hmm. See, there's always overlap.
There is.
Worlds of entertainment and sports.
Mm-hmm.
The Sonics began play in October of 1967 in the Washington State Coliseum. In 1968, the Sonics acquired Lenny Wilkins in a trade, and he was their first really good player,
mm-hmm,
who sort of elevated the franchise. Wilkins was a point guard who was, like, an all-around great versatile player.
Mm-hmm.
The year after he joined the team, he actually became a player coach like Pete Rose, and he coached the team while also being a point guard for a little bit.
It seems like when you have, like, a star veteran player on a team, you always hear the rhetoric of, like, everyone else is gonna, like, elevate and rise to the occasion because of that person's leadership. So, like, whether or not it's, like, an official thing that they name someone a player coach, like, you can't tell me that, like, LeBron is LeBron is probably doing some coaching.
yeah a lot of pointers here and there at least. So in 1971 the Sonics got a player named Spencer Haywood, and we're gonna take a little detour on Haywood here. Haywood was an all-star player from the rival ABA at the time, because there was another league going on. The Sonics wanted him, but the NBA had a rule at the time that said that a player was not eligible to play in the NBA until they were 4 years out of high school.
Oh.
So even though he was playing professionally in this other league that didn't have that rule,
mm-hmm,
he was only 2 years into that other league.
And you didn't have to have gone to college during those 4 years. You just had to be 4 years out of high school.
Yeah, assuming you would go to college.
Okay.
Sort of. So Haywood challenged the rule,
mm-hmm,
that was, like, the 4 year eligibility rule. And the case went all the way to the Supreme Court.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. And the case was Haywood versus National Basketball Association. Yeah.
Wow.
I'm going to play a little news piece just so you can kind of hear a little bit more about this. This is a Detroit local news piece on this Spencer Haywood thing that was done more recently.
Okay.
I ended up being the outstanding college player of the year.
He then went pro to the ABA's Denver Rockets, where he was the MVP, Rookie of the Year, and the MVP of the All-Star Game. The owner of the NBA's Seattle Supersonics found out about Haywood and wanted him, so we offered him a better contract. One problem, Haywood wasn't 4 years removed from high school, which at the time was an NBA rule.
I walk out on the floor and they said, ladies and gentlemen, we have an illegal player on the floor, number 24.
That's when Haywood decided to take on the NBA. As the case went through the courts, Haywood was often booed and often disrespected. Not even the Players Association supported him. Aww. Haywood versus the National Basketball Association went all the way to the Supreme Court. It was decided March 1st, 1971, 7-2 in favor of the 21-year-old rookie. Haywood would go on to have a 14-year career in the league. Haywood was inducted into the Naismith Memorial Basketball Hall of Fame in 2015.
What a cool story.
Yeah.
I had no idea.
So he got the rule rewritten, which sort of paved the way for all players who were wanting to come out of high school early, or these rules have changed over the years. Like, they've put in different limits.
Why was the NBA so staunchly for that period of time? I feel like, obviously, like, encouraging people to go to college, I understand, but like, not everybody is going to go to college, and 4 years, if you're not playing for, I guess at the time, the other basketball league, like, you would kind of lose it if you're not.
Yeah, it was mostly college forcing people to go there, sort of keeping college basketball going by not allowing those players to leave so early so that the product was better in college.
Yeah. Well, because nowadays people go for like a year and then leave if they're really good.
They'll do a year, or they'll go right from high school, which they can do again, or they'll go to one of these other leagues that's like right out of high school, like overtime elite, that gets you ready.
I understand like trying to like respect the institution of college, but also like in my older years, I like view everything now as like, oh, it's because of capitalism. It's because the colleges wanted money and they want people to go pay to go to the college.
Yeah. And they want people to go to the basketball games.
Yeah.
To have the good players.
Duh.
Yeah. So, yeah, that was a big monumental sort of case for basketball players.
Yeah.
And the best player on the Sonics, Spencer Haywood, was at the center.
What a cool guy.
Yeah. So the team changed around, and then Wilkins and Haywood left, but the team improved. And for a bit, they hired NBA legend Bill Russell, who's like one of the best players of all time, as their coach.
Heard of him.
He died like a year or two ago.
Oh.
Yeah. In 1973, the Sonics introduced their very first mascot.
Oh, I don't even know what it is.
And the first mascot was a mascot named Weedle. After a children's book, Weedle on the Needle.
I was about to say, Weedle rhymes a lot with needle,
which was
the Space Needle is a big thing there.
Children's book written about sort of like the Space Needle and this guy Weedle. I'm going to show you Weedle. So Weedle, if you want to describe him, he kind of fits the mold of the mascot at that time.
Okay, so you know what I'm going to say. I have a really passionate take. This is a hill I will die on, that we need to bring back mascots like this, because he's just a big furry guy. You don't really know what he is. There's elements of like bear. There's elements of, I don't know.
Caterpillar.
Yeah. Like, he's just a big furry dude. He's got a tiny little hat on, which is hilarious. He's riding around on a bicycle. He joins in my heart the pantheon of Big Shot, who is the former mascot for the Sixers, the Philly Fanatic, is just a weird guy, weird furry guy, and then Gritty, weird furry guy. Philadelphia really had it figured out.
Yeah, I think we've definitely come back around on the weird furry guy trend in mascots, but
more
Weedle,
weird furry guys.
Weedle was one of them.
I do like that one mascot that's a tree, though.
Oh, yeah, the Stanford tree?
Yeah, it's literally just like a pine tree.
Yeah, he's pretty cool. Have you ever seen the ESPN commercial? They used to do this series where they would have their analysts around the office, and then there would be like goofy things happening in the world of sports as if all of sports happened in the office, kind of.
I vaguely remember this.
Anyway, there's a really good one, one of my favorite ones of all time, where the tree is just standing right next to the trash and recycling, and one of the people that works at ESPN goes to throw away something and accidentally throws it in the garbage, a piece of paper, and the tree just shakes its head, and then the guy goes, oh, and puts it back in the recycling, as if he just stands there making sure people recycle.
He just monitors.
That's his job.
I love that.
So in 1978, the Sonics brought back Lenny Wilkins as head coach this time. He's no longer playing. And the team got better. They made the NBA Finals and they lost to the Washington Bullets. Side note on the Bullets. The Bullets are now the Washington Wizards.
Mm-hmm.
In November of 1995, owner Abe Pollin announced he was changing the team's nickname because the Bullets had acquired a violent overtone that had made them increasingly uncomfortable over the years, particularly given the high homicide rates and crime in the early 90s in DC.
Yeah, it's not great.
So you had a team named after gun violence.
That's not great.
Okay, so I know what you're thinking. Did the Bullets have a big fluffy bullet mascot with the like flying bullets in Mario or like a big fluffy bullet guy?
Uh-huh.
Nope, they had something so much better. They had what I can confidently say is probably going to be your favorite mascot of all time.
Wait, really?
Yes. They had two dachshunds that were shaped like bullets, they thought, named Alex the Bullet and Tiny BB.
Wait. Actual dogs?
Actual dogs. Because they thought they were shaped like a bullet.
You know, I get it.
And I'm going to show you some pictures of this dogs coming to
games. My God.
So I guess the story Alex the Bullet dies and then Tiny BB takes over. But for a while, it was just Alex. But this is Bullet superstar Tiny BB. And can you describe him?
Oh, not without crying. He's a beautiful, beautiful boy. And he's got sunglasses. And is he wearing some kind of hat?
I think in some of these.
Yeah. He's so cute. I love dachshunds. Dachshunds are probably my favorite dogs. Oh my God, he's on a little fire truck. And he's inside a bullet. And even though that's so ridiculous, it's so cute. It's a little bullet on wheels and he has a little cape.
You're going to have to go to YouTube or social to see.
Tiny too. Did Tiny die? And then this is his.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
See, this is the problem with having an actual animal as your mascot. They die.
Yeah, and then you got to keep getting new ones. So that was a little. Tangent I thought we needed to take.
That is, well, no, we definitely needed to take it. It reminds me, I used to live in Lakeview, and there used to be this dachshund that my dear friend Charlie and I would call Tiniest Cubs Fan. Lived together at the time, and this dog would always be around Lakeview with his person, who I'm assuming was also a Cubs fan. And the dog, the reason we called him that is because he had a tiny little Cubs hat that had holes for his ears, and he just looked so freaking cute.
Yeah. He was the Tiniest Cubs Fan.
He was the Tiniest Cubs Fan. One time I saw Tiniest Cubs Fan eating a sliced up hot dog.
Oh, so good.
Yeah.
Was it a Chicago dog?
I don't know. It was just a plain sliced up hot dog on a plate. His person was having an actual hot dog the table.
So it wasn't a Chicago dog.
I mean, he's a Chicago dog.
I know. He is. He doesn't need to eat one to prove that.
May he rest in peace, because I assume he looked a little old by the time I left Lakeview, and it's been a while. So.
R.I.P. Tiniest Cubs Fan. Mm. So the year after, in 1979, in 78, they made it to the finals, lost to the Bullets. They made it back to the NBA Finals the next year, and again, they faced the Bullets. But this time, they won, and they won the NBA championship.
Good
the first
for
one
them.
In Sonics history.
And that's been like, what, about like 13 years since they started?
Yeah, 79. They started in 66.
I think you said 66.
Yeah.
Good for them.
In 1983, the Sonics were sold. The original owners sold them to a man named Barry Ackerley.
Okay.
From 83 to 89, under Ackerley, the Sonics were not very good. Ackerley was an ad man. He started by selling ad space in better homes and gardens.
Oh.
And his advertising company specialized in outdoor billboard practical advertising in California.
Very current. Definitely stands the test of time. Yep. A good investment of money.
Yep.
For sure.
Oh, these were the days when, like, you went to do a journalism degree like I did, or like a communications degree, and you're like, I'm going to do billboards.
And yeah, because it's like the thing that you recognize as like having ads on it. Yeah. And now anytime I see a billboard, it's for a casino.
A James Corden vehicle.
Yes. A casino. James Corden performing at a casino. Like a naughty, a strip club. I don't know why I was, what I was going to say, naughty.
A naughty. Oh, I got one. Brian Urlacher with hair now.
I don't know who that is.
He's a
yes,
former Chicago Bears linebacker who was bald.
Yes, because his hair.
But the billboards are all over Chicago because Urlacher got his hair back, and you can too.
Yeah, because it's like for like hair plugs or whatever. And then if you're in certain parts of the country, you see very violent billboards about Jesus.
Oh, yeah. Everywhere.
And
everywhere.
What Jesus likes and doesn't like.
Yep. 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 Yeah. Urlacher and Jesus.
Yeah.
That's the billboard market right now. Later, Ackerley's company became a broadcast media company, which then sold to Clear Channel, and he made a ton of money.
Smart pivot.
Smart pivot. So in 1989, the Sonics began sort of this new era after they kind of were not doing well. When they drafted forward Sean Kemp.
That name sounds familiar.
And then guard Gary Payton.
Sounds familiar.
Okay. So 89 was Kemp and then 90 was Payton.
Okay.
Back-to-back years, really high draft picks. And these were the guys for me growing up.
Oh.
Yeah. Kemp was insane and he was like the big dunker.
Mm-hmm.
And Payton was known as the glove.
Mm.
And he was really good at defense because he stuck to you like a glove.
Oh, okay.
Like,
gotcha.
On your hand like a glove.
Don't make that
gesture. I'm not going to do that ever again. So I actually have an entire page of Gary Payton cards in my book.
Wow.
I was going to show it, but I don't have it.
Is it in Beaver Dam, Wisconsin?
No, it's in the house, but I don't know where it is. I think it's in the...
Let's do five more minutes on where we think your basketball cards are. Is it in one?
It's one of the storage bins or something. I should get it.
It's you don't need to get it. People know what a basketball card looks
like.
Yeah,
but I have like a whole page.
People can
Gary
imagine
Payton.
What a whole page of basketball cards looks like.
3 pages of just Gary Payton's. That's how much I was into him. Okay.
So for those of you listening and watching, close your eyes. Okay. Take a deep breath in and a deep breath out. You're going into our apartment, into the storage room. You're opening a storage bin. You're like, oh, a big binder. You open the big binder. You turn 3 whole pages.
Well, first you're going to have to pass a ton of NBA players that also have their own pages.
Jim! Whatever. People can imagine it. It's fine.
Yep.
Can I see a picture of him just on the internet?
Yeah.
Nice.
All right. That's Gary Payton.
Cool.
In 1992, when the Sonics brought in coach George Karl, that's when they really returned to playoff prominence.
Okay.
They had Kemp and Payton, and then the following year after that, they got Karl. He's this very hot-headed coach.
Mm.
He was a good coach for them and sort of like brought them a new spark of energy.
Hot-headed meaning like he yelled a lot on the sidelines? Okay.
Yeah. I knew that because he, after the Sonics, he coached for the Bucks for a while.
So okay.
George Karl had a whole reign over Milwaukee.
Mm.
In 1993, the Sonics made a pivot as part of this new sort of 90s dominance era where they're like, we got Kemp, we got Payton. We need a new mascot that like fits the new vibe. We're going to pivot from Weedle and the big fluffy guy to a mascot named Squatch.
Like Sasquatch?
You got it. Like
Is
Sasquatch.
Washington known for the Sasquatch?
Well, you know, he might be up there in some of those trees.
He might be anywhere.
He might be anywhere.
Schrodinger's Sasquatch.
Everything's Schrodinger's. So much like the Greg Norman episode, I didn't make a PowerPoint, but I did make a detailed list of all the things that Squatch can do.
Okay.
And I'm going to show you videos of all the things
I can't wait.
Squatch does. Here first is just a classic Squatch doing an inline skate dunk.
Oh my God.
Watch Squatch with inline skates launched by Slingshot.
He looks like Chewbacca.
Yep.
What, 20 feet in the air and finishes strong at the cup.
Watch he looks like Uncanny Valley Chewbacca.
Look at that.
I mean, that's pretty impressive.
3-point line dunk on inline skates by a Sasquatch.
Is this like a player who didn't make the team?
He very well could have been.
Because, like, you can't do that without being an athlete.
No. The next one I'm going to show you is Squatch snowboarding down some stairs.
Nice.
Look him go.
Kids, don't try this at home. Actually, I see this all the time at the mall. Only the kids are coming down on the rail.
I mean, the thing I'm most impressed with is how quickly he took the snowboard off.
Yeah, he really got out of those bindings real quick. Yeah, that guy definitely snowboards.
Mm-hmm.
That Sasquatch definitely snowboards.
The job description for Squatch required a lot of multi-talented
skills. Here's one where he stilt boxes against Samson, the Kings mascot.
Oh, my God.
47-34, Kings lead the Sonics. 5:47 to go, second quarter in the battle of the mascots.
Just no.
Down goes Squatch.
That looked like it hurt.
Squatch did all he could to stay on his feet, unable to do so. He's knocked down in the first round here in the matchup with Samson.
This is like American Gladiator stuff.
Yeah, yeah. So Squatch got in a fight there. Other thing that he did was drum on the trailer. Apparently, Sasquatches can play the drums.
That handsome devil Squatch has taken his act to Broadway and other Seattle streets as well. He stopped by Fisher Plaza today for a short engagement. Listen up. He's not bad. Our hairy friend is being towed all over town on a trailer trying to drum up excitement for the NBA Finals, which began right here on Como tonight. In fact, right after...
And then lastly, in the vein of Greg Norman, here's Squatch wakeboarding. I love the sort of grunge Foo Fighters.
Yeah.
So yeah, Squatch is wakeboarding.
I just can't stop thinking about, first of all, how sweaty this one person or multiple people are inside that Chewbacca outfit doing all of this. And I also am thinking about like whatever costuming company had to like get the suit back in after having been wakeboarded in.
Oh yeah.
And they're like, well, I guess we'll just throw it out.
Good thing we made another.
I'm imagining it's just like a tough old broad who does costumes or whatever. She's like, what did you do with it? Nothing. We didn't do anything with it. It's just sweat.
Did you dunk it in the ocean or something?
Why is the fur all matted?
The fur is all matted and it smells like salt. All right. So back to the timeline here. In 92 and 93, the Sonics make it to the Western Conference Finals against the Suns and they lose. Mm. In the following season, 93-94, they had the best record in the NBA, but they lost to the Nuggets in the first round of the playoffs.
Mm.
In 95-96... the Sonics moved into their updated arena, which is now called Key Arena. They moved out of there for a little bit, and then they had to update the arena and then moved back into it.
Okay.
And they had their most stacked roster probably in franchise history. It was Gary Payton, Sean Kemp, German superstar Detlef Schrempf, Hersey Hawkins, and Nate McMillan in the starting five. I'm going to play a little clip, and this is from a documentary which I reference heavily from here on out, called Sonics Gate, and it's a documentary about sort of this whole story I'm telling you today.
I just want to say, people in sports, you have to be a little more creative. You can't just put gate after everything.
Don't tell that to the makers of this documentary.
In 1995, the city renovated the Coliseum, renaming it Key Arena and giving it the bells and whistles required by the NBA and its commissioner, David Stern.
How does our Key Arena stack up, and how do you like it so far?
It's very special to me. I know what a struggle it was for the Sonics and the Ackerley family, who very much wanted to have this team playing in a beautiful building. They got a beautiful building. It's intimate. The sight lines are great. The decorations are terrific. I think Seattle should be very proud of what's going on here tonight.
So that's a little bit on the arena. And the commissioner at the time, David Stern, who you saw there, sort of pushed them to get better accommodations. And so they updated the arena to make it more of a modern arena in that sort of 95, 96 time. So the 95, 96 team that I mentioned was like stacked with Schrempf and stuff. This team probably should have won the title, but they happened to be playing at the same time as Michael Jordan and the dominant Bulls.
I had a feeling that at some point the character of Michael Jordan would appear in this saga and dash some dreams, just because, like, as we got further into the 90s, I was like, this is when the Bulls just won everything.
Yeah. you do know that much about the NBA that the Bulls...
I do. Well, because it was such a... Like, this is really where sports and culture overlap quite a bit, yeah. I think, for our generation. Like, the NBA in the 90s was so in the zeitgeist of, like, everything. Like, clothing, commercials, movies, like, TV show. Like, it was absolutely everywhere. Like, the NBA was just a huge part of, like... pop culture in general. Like, I vividly remember that player on the Bulls who had always had different color
Dennis
hair.
Dennis Rodman. He was everywhere.
Vividly, Dennis Rodman was absolutely everywhere. He was dating Carmen Electra.
We're going to do a Rodman episode.
He was dating Carmen Electra. People were wearing like NBA starter jackets everywhere. I had like a Utah Jazz hat that I wore all the time.
This was also the rise of NBA player-centric sneakers, Air Jordans, Shaq shoes. I believe like Sean Kemp probably had a shoe, like everyone had.
Like, there's actually like quite the influence of 90s NBA on music and clothing and just pop culture in general, like, is huge. And I think anybody, even me, who was not paying attention to the actual sports of it, like, who didn't have like one of those like Looney Tunes basketball shirts or like pieces of merchandise? I would kill for one now.
Yeah, like Taz Sonics thing or whatever.
Yes.
Or Charlotte Hornets.
Oh my God, the Charlotte, yeah, the Hornets.
This team that should have won the title loses to Michael Jordan and the Bulls. The team did well the next couple of years, but in 1998, George Karl, fiery as he was, left after some disputes with the team. The next decade was pretty rough, but notably in 2001, the team was sold by Ackerley to none other than Seattle legend and Starbucks president and CEO Howard Schultz.
Oh, the Starbucks guy.
The Starbucks guy. When making the sale, Ackerley was quoted saying, "One of our biggest considerations was that the Sonics stay in Seattle. We are leaving the team and the fans in good hands." Meanwhile, Schultz was trying to sort of hardball people and run the Sonics like a coffee company. He's kind of laughed at by players in the NBA community for being sort of like emotional on the sidelines, trying to sort of run things like a business, that he's familiar with.
How do you run a basketball team like a coffee company?
Usually that just means try to spend as little money as possible on players and try to complain about money.
Yeah. Food service, you cut a lot of corners.
Produce this product cheaper and cheaper and cheaper and make more money on it?
Yes. Yeah.
So he didn't pay Gary Payton very well, like contract dispute type thing that
and
happens
Gary
all the time.
Payton
now,
at this point, has been there for a long time.
He's been there for a while,
like,
and he's
carrying
their
the
best
team.
Player.
Yeah.
He leaves to go to Milwaukee, joins George Karl over there.
Nice.
And they kind of do their thing. But the city was pretty annoyed with Gary Payton leaving because he probably had a disagreement with Schultz over money.
Yeah.
So they're like, okay, Schultz comes in, buys the team, and immediately we lose Payton and kind of like...
And like, I'm sure Gary Payton was like everything to Seattle.
Yeah. So Wally Walker, the GM, who was sort of complaining along with Schultz about salaries just getting too high and we can't compete, is thinking like, hey, we don't have the budget to compete with teams like the Portland Trailblazers, who have $100 million payrolls and we only have $50 million. And we need ways to get more money. And at the time, that way to get money was mostly with in-person ticket sales, food sales, and stuff like that, because the contracts for TV rights weren't as good and they weren't giving as much money back to teams that way. This is a quote from a little piece on this that accompanies a podcast called Sonic Boom about this story that The Ringer did, and then I just kind of pulled some things from their coverage of it. No one saw it coming, Walker said. People that were in the league didn't see it changing that quickly. So Walker, former Sonics executive vice president Terry McLaughlin, former mayor Greg Nichols, and a few others put together a plan. They want to renovate Key Arena again. They want to double the footprint and add luxury suites, and they make a pitch that out-of-towners can pay for a lot of it through taxes on hotels. Seems like a decent enough plan, but there was a problem. Howard Schultz in like 03, 04 started making noise about wanting a new building altogether, Chris Daniels says, a reporter from King 5 TV in Seattle. Well, that building was less than a decade old, the previous one.
Mm-hmm.
And then Andy, I'll have you read.
Quote, you already have a baseball stadium and a football stadium, and that's where people were like, enough is enough. I mean, the political climate in this town was like, no more. There'd been three asks within a decade. Well, we even had a term for it, he says. Sports facility fatigue. Of course, the public remembered, hey, Key Arena, wasn't that just remodeled? You know, I like going to games there. And they were right. That was one of the hardest battles in terms of perception, because it's a fun place to watch a game. We're like, yeah, we agree. But the reality was it just wasn't economically competitive. I get that. I would have a problem with knowing that my tax dollars, instead of going toward, like, I don't know, programs and services that the city needed, were going toward continuing to build giant sports arenas, when I know that there are people in the world who have money to build giant sports yeah. arenas. They're just not doing it.
And you just paid for two giant sports arenas.
Right.
In your city,
it's
through
like
your taxes.
You can make the case that it would stimulate the economy in your city and it's fun and whatever, and that's all true. But like, that does sort of take a toll. When a city starts to have more of a sports presence,
mm-hmm.
they need a place to put them. I just don't understand this model of like making the people pay for the stadiums.
Yeah.
That's like a weird model to me.
It is. It is.
And I did not know that that was like the norm. I mean, speaking from the perspective of a drama kid, people who don't watch sports especially are going to want nothing to do with
right.
paying
yeah.
for the facility. I love any large space we can put Beyonce in to perform, but we're talking about one concert.
Yeah. It's not 35 Beyonce shows.
Then we can talk. I mean... Then we can talk about how much of my tax dollars you want.
So in the early 2000s, the best team that the Sonics had was the 04-05 team. They had players like Rashard Lewis and Ray Allen, and they made the playoffs but lost to the San Antonio Spurs with Tony Parker, Tim Duncan, and that team that won all
it
the
all comes
finals.
Full circle.
In 2005, the city refused to negotiate the team's lease at Key Arena, and the state legislature refused to help the team fund a new stadium. In 2006, Schultz and NBA Commissioner David Stern asked the legislature in Washington to fund a new Key Arena remodel, and I'll play a little clip about that here.
We're here because we want to be here. We love the city. Our families have been raised here.
This is Howard Schultz.
Have been built here, and everything about this ownership group and everything about the Seattle Storm and the Seattle Supersonics is Northwest, and we do not want to see that in any way go away.
The NBA is,
this is David
very
Stern.
Proud of the support that both the Sonics and the Storm have received from the Seattle community, the King County community, and the state of Washington over the years. Is a source of great pride to us.
Now here is where the drama gets heightened. The idea of selling the Sonics comes up with Howard Schultz and his sort of team of people.
Mm-hmm.
Again, from the Ringer podcast and blog about the Sonics called Sonic Boom. Here's some things from there.
Former Sonics forward and front office executive Wally Walker remembers these early conversations about whether to sell. Quote, it has to be a group that's committed to keeping the team here, Walker says. That was the criterion, and it was sincere. I have no doubt that everyone, including Howard, thought that, said that, and was consistent with that. I just threw it out there because I thought the $350 million no one would pay, Walker says. At this point, Seattle had entered its period of exponential growth, but still, there was not nearly as much wealth in town as there is today. So they had only a few real local options, and none were coming together. They had a brief conversation with Steve Ballmer, who was then the CEO at Microsoft and is now the owner of the Los Angeles Clippers. But he was just not in a place in life where he could give a team the attention it requires. But then they had a call with someone who sounded kind of promising. Quote, but what happened was there was an interested party from Oklahoma City by the name of Ed Evans, Walker says. Ed Evans was a guy that was known by people of our ownership group. And not only that, but Ed Evans and his wife had their first date in Seattle at Canlee.
Yeah.
Walker says. So this guy, Ed Evans, he's talking to the ownership group and he's telling them about his first date with his wife in Seattle, going on and on about how much he loves the city. He said all the right things, that if he and his group bought the team, they were keeping it here. In fact, he said he was going to move here because he was living in Oklahoma City, not from Oklahoma City. My recollection. He was just a man who'd made a lot of money and was eager to get into sports ownership. He didn't really care where. And again, he loved Seattle. So they kept talking. At this point, it's summer, the off season. And even though the board was entertaining these conversations, life had to go on. So Wally left for a vacation in France. And while he's there, he was notified that he needed to be on another conference call. On the call, there was Ed Evans. But then there's another guy, someone quieter, with more of an Oklahoma drawl. He didn't have quite Ed Evans's charm. At the time, this man was known for giving the New Orleans Hornets a temporary home in Oklahoma City. Clay Bennett.
So enter Clay Bennett, the guy who jumps in on this sort of buying the team conversation.
I see where this is going.
I'm going to play a little clip again from SonicSkate about Clay Bennett so that you can get a little better idea of who this guy is who sort of enters the picture sort of under the radar in the conversation of buying the Sonics.
A big barrel of a man, Clay Bennett was born and raised in Oklahoma City, where his close-cropped haircut remains forever in style. He married his high school sweetheart, Louise Gaylord, whose family owns the Daily Oklahoman newspaper. Bennett founded the private investment firm Dorchester Capital, making millions investing his wife's family fortune. In the 1990s, Bennett became a minority owner of the San Antonio Spurs and a team representative for the NBA's Board of Governors. In 2005, when Hurricane Katrina made it impossible for the Hornets to continue playing basketball in New Orleans, Bennett helped his old friend David Stern temporarily relocate the team to Oklahoma City for 1.5 seasons.
So, like the clip said, throughout all those years of Clay being sort of on the margins of basketball, helping out with the Hornets and the Spurs, him and Stern become really close
and
friends.
Stern at the time is the commissioner.
He's
the
commissioner
NBA?
Of the whole NBA. The $350 million number that was put out there that was like, oh, this is just like a moonshot number. They said they would pay it. Like Clay Bennett said they would pay it.
He called their bluff.
The Schultz group was like, oh, we never actually thought we'd have to consider this. But they didn't feel like totally great about it and whether or not they could trust these new guys. Clay Bennett also had another guy involved with this called Aubrey McClendon, and he was the CEO of Chesapeake Energy, another Oklahoma company.
Okay.
So Wally is in France on this call meeting these new guys.
That's
and he's
gotta
looking
be
into
a
them.
Vacation ruiner.
Yeah.
I feel bad.
He's like, these guys are very Oklahoma City, and so I don't exactly know what to
he's
think
like,
about them.
Why do they want a team that's going to stay in Seattle?
Yeah. So from 2001 to 2006, Howard Schultz was the majority owner, and on July 18th, 2006, after unsuccessful efforts to persuade Washington governments and officials to update Key Arena, Schultz sells the Supersonics and the Storm as a package, which he owned both of them.
Is that the WNBA team?
WNBA okay. team to Clay Bennett and that group of Oklahoma City businessmen for $350 million.
And while all this was going down, I was having the summer of my life as a counselor in training at my Jewish overnight camp.
And not thinking at all about basketball.
No.
So Schultz sort of put the blame on elected officials and all that because he was like, well, you guys didn't want to keep it here by adding a new arena.
Okay.
And he really wanted a new arena in order to make it profitable or whatever if he was going to keep the company or if he was going to keep...
I mean, you need to have money to pay for players. And if the arena is the main way that you make money and the arena only has like a maximum amount of money that it can make, I get that it's a tough situation.
Yeah. But Schultz didn't like just do this because he was like, my hand's forced and I need to get out. He made a ton of money.
Oh, yeah.
He bought it for $200 million and flipped it for $350 in a matter of years.
Yeah.
So he made a lot of money.
And I don't know if his... What was it? Starbucks?
Yeah.
Did they do anything?
So in 2007, the Sonics were awarded the second pick in the NBA draft. This was the highest that they ever drafted. And they chose Kevin Durant from University of Texas.
Wait a minute. Really?
Yeah. KD was drafted by the Sonics in 2007, right on the precipice of this like sale stuff going down.
So they were still going and still in Seattle, but they had been sold.
Yes.
And I did not, man, KD's been around for a long time.
Yeah.
And he has been on, it's funny to me because he's been on so many teams, and it's funny to me that he's on the Sonics, which is like, of course he also managed to be on the Sonics.
Yeah, yeah. So in 2008, the team was bad, but Durant won Rookie of the Year in his first year.
He's a talented man.
This was also the year where it started to become very evident that the city was not going to fund a new arena project. So after failing to persuade local governments to fund a $500 million arena complex in Seattle or in the suburb of Renton, Bennett's group notified the NBA that it actually intended to move the team to Oklahoma City and requested arbitration with the city of Seattle to be released from their lease at Key Arena, which they still had a couple of years left on. The judge rejected the request, and Seattle sued Bennett's group to enforce the lease that required them to play at Key Arena until 2010. And despite Kevin Durant being this new rookie sensation, the media were sort of kept at arm's length, and critics of the move and the new OKC ownership group would say that they like intentionally tried to cut the team off from Seattle.
The spotlight.
So that maybe they could get away with this move to Oklahoma City thing, and it would be like the team needed to go and wasn't wanted. And here's a little clip from SonicsGate about that.
The moves that were being made, the trades, the shedding of salary, that last season, they were just atrocious. And it just seemed like it was all part of a plan to make people not interested in the Sonics, to make people not attend games.
Players were off limits to a great degree to media. Media never really got to know the young Kevin Durant and Jeff Green. They were completely kept at arm's length.
Everything was so controlled, and it was all to kind of turn us off, turn the city off. Their whole game plan was to get out of town and create as much ill will in the process as they could.
And if you had a playoff drive that year, this building would have been packed. But no one wanted to go down and put money in Clay Bennett's pocket, knowing that Clay Bennett had no desire to stay here.
I've said repeatedly what our intentions are. And that's what they are, is to be successful here.
When you aren't selling tickets actively, you aren't doing anything to promote, you won't let your players go on sports radio to talk about the team, you won't, you know, you basically did everything but lock the doors to keep people out of this building.
I would love to hear what Kevin Durant thought about this, because that's got to be a really, really annoying situation to be put in your rookie season when you're having an incredible season. And he must have noticed that he was not getting the amount of press that like a very successful rookie would get. That would really annoy me, because then you feel like your whole career is like, well, what's going to happen if like the team that I'm currently playing on in the city I'm currently playing in is literally in the middle of like this weird dramatic like negotiation.
Yeah, it's definitely not great to start what would go on to be a amazing career.
It's like a baby being born during an active divorce.
Yeah. On April 18th, 2008, NBA owners approved a potential Supersonics relocation to Oklahoma City in a 28-2 vote by the league's board of governors. Only Mark Cuban of Dallas and Paul Allen of Portland voted against the move.
Mark Cuban.
Mark Cuban, Shark Tank, baby. The approval meant the Supersonics would be allowed to move to OKC at the Ford Center in 2008-2009 after reaching a settlement with the city of Seattle. On July 2nd, 2008, a settlement that allowed the team to move under certain conditions was finally awarded. It was agreed that Oklahoma City would not use the name Supersonics, and the team's history would be shared between Oklahoma City and any future NBA team in Seattle.
Wait a minute. The team's history would be shared any future team in Seattle.
I guess like any team that was Seattle will be all Seattle, and Oklahoma City is Seattle. Like Gary Payton essentially played for Oklahoma City like retroactively. Like,
and Oklahoma City is Seattle.
Yeah, which is something that really annoys Seattle.
That's really
people.
Funny.
The relocated team began play as Oklahoma City Thunder for 2008 and 2009. In months prior to the settlement, Seattle publicly released email conversations that took place within Bennett's ownership group and alleged that they indicated at least some members of the group wanted to move the team to OKC right away when they were buying it.
Mm-hmm.
And when the emails were released, it caused chaos in Seattle because this was a look behind the
scenes. Emails will do that.
This is Hillary Clinton's emails, but it's Clay Bennett's emails.
Could it be the smoking gun that helps keep the Sonics in Seattle? Emails last April between Clay Bennett and the team's other co-owners suggest that the plan was to move the team to Oklahoma City all along.
Tom Ward starts the conversation with the query, is there any way to move here for the next season, or are we doomed to have another lame duck season in Seattle? To which Clay Bennett responds, I am a man possessed. I will do everything we can. Thanks for hanging with me, boys. The game is getting started. Finally, Aubrey McClendon signals his approval. That's the spirit. I'm willing to help any way I can to watch ball here next year.
You can't trust a grown man who refers to his other grown man friends as boys.
Yeah, that is a good point.
That's just something I've learned in my life experience.
All right, now here's a little continuation of the clip where Clay Bennett is sort of defending himself.
Okay.
And essentially just acting dumb.
I clearly recall that email exchange. My absolute feeling and notion in that email is, I am a man possessed. I am only beginning. I will do everything I can to get this done in Seattle. And there's been an enormous misunderstanding of that, misrepresentation of that. It's been misconstrued. I'm not sure which. But I was speaking about my commitment to a process in Seattle.
He's literally rewriting his email exchange in the press conference saying he meant Seattle. That's like textbook lying, like dumb guy lying.
I
didn't mean that. And literally just telling people, gaslighting everyone.
So if your significant other is texting with someone and the other person is like, do you want to cheat on your partner with me? And your significant other text back, I am a man possessed. I am committed to making it happen. Do you read that and you're like, oh, definitely this person wants to stay with me and not cheat
on me. Committed to making my previous relationship
happen.
Does
he know how like dialogue works? He's literally responding to the in an email that someone else sent.
Oh my God. Like we know the context of this exchange. Like Jesus.
Yeah. I get it that he never said Sonics or Oklahoma in that email. But
it's so clearly a lawyer told him, hey, you never said it in the exchange, so just lie and say you never meant it.
I know.
But it's so gross. He's clearly lying, makes him look really dumb. And then we find out more in emails with Clay Bennett and David Stern that just show like how buddy-buddy those guys are and have been.
That's got to look bad for David Stern.
Stern to Bennett. It pains me to see the situation you are in, and I have difficulty conjuring a happy ending in Seattle, but I appreciate your efforts and very greatly value our friendship. Bennett to Stern. You know how I feel about our relationship, both personally and professionally. I view you as a role model and as an extraordinarily gifted executive, a deep and compassionate thinker. You are just one of my favorite people on earth, and I so cherish our relationship.
I think that it showed that there was a relationship between those two men that may have been closer than Stern had with other owners.
They kissed.
I thought it was fucked up, to be honest with you. I mean.
Those two guys were joined at the hip. Clay Bennett worshiped David Stern and followed him around like a puppy trying to do anything to get in his good graces.
Those emails, they show a level of deception and just dishonesty and bad faith that to me, you know, I hope they haunt those guys for their career.
They hooked up.
Definitely hooked up. So Seattle uses these incidents and these emails as a way to argue that the owners failed to negotiate in good faith. So a lot of Seattle fans and people in the city are sort of making this argument.
I mean, I would agree.
And they prompted Howard Schultz to file a lawsuit seeking to rescind the sale of the team and transfer ownership to a court-appointed receiver for the time being.
Damn.
And the NBA said Schultz's lawsuit was void because Schultz signed a release forbidding him to pursue legal action against Bennett's group, and it would violate league ownership rules. And so Schultz dropped the case before the start of the 08-09 season.
He dropped it like a hot caramel macchiato in his lap.
Yeah, but if you did that, then you would have a lawsuit of a different kind.
That's true. Yeah.
For hot drinks in the lap. Here's a little clip of David Stern getting interrogated by a local Seattle reporter about some of the stuff. That's a good watch.
And let's settle it once and for all with Key Arena. There is a $300 million proposal out there. Is that a significant proposal and something that could solve the problem?
Actually, there's no proposal out there right now. And I don't think you would mean to misrepresent that to me, would you?
When I went into this room, I wasn't planning on having any sort of adversarial or confrontational questioning with David Stern. I thought that they were questions that a lot of people had wanted answered for several months at that point. City of Seattle believes that this $300 million Key Arena proposal, if it was funded, would be good enough to house an NBA team going forward in the future. Would Key Arena, if that proposal ever finds the funding for it, it's been talked about for several years, but would it be something that would be viable for an NBA arena in the future?
I'm not going to talk about how many angels you can fit upon the head of a pin, because this is a perpetual subject that gets discussed and discussed and discussed, and nothing ever gets done and hasn't been done.
Over the last week or so, there's been several emails that have come out, including a lengthy email exchange between you and Mr. Bennett, and emails between Mr. Bennett and his fellow owners. Have you had a chance to read through those emails?
My response,
yet?
As I've been reminded, wasn't lengthy at all. So
have you read through those emails? Especially those between Mr. Bennett and the other owners.
Live or not, I don't like to be interrupted, and I'm not going to interrupt you. So why don't we just go to the next question?
He's just getting called out, and he can't. He looks so bad. He's just saying he never read the things and, like, lying through his teeth and, like, trying to take the high ground over the reporter.
Powerful men, when they are being taken to task or questioned, love to deflect with, I'm not going to talk about a bunch of different things that might be possible, because why would I talk about things that could happen or might happen or may happen?
It's so gross. And
it's just like, because someone's asking you what might happen.
And he just like tries to play it off and not even address it. Like the guy's not even asking a real question.
Gross.
Seattle feels totally duped and they're going to lose their team and it sucks. So the last game that the Supersonics have is a game where Kevin Durant, their new rookie, is playing against what would be his future team, the Golden State Warriors.
Mm.
And he scores 42 points for the Sonics team.
Which is a lot for basketball
that is about to leave. And all the fans mm-hmm. know that. And they're hoping that they can save their Sonics. And they cheer that as Kevin Durant eggs them on in this last game.
Wow, this is someone's, like, personal video.
Yeah, it's like a phone.
Wow.
And that Save Our Sonics cheer would become sort of a recurring theme throughout all of this stuff
mm-hmm.
from the fan side.
Mm-hmm.
Because all this backroom dealing is going on, the fans are, like, throwing rallies, trying to show that they do support a team and they do want a team there
mm-hmm.
and maybe want to support funding an arena if they were able to get it through,
mm-hmm.
just trying to, you know, show interest, but it was too little too late. The Sonics leave Seattle for Oklahoma City. And like I mentioned earlier, the history of the team moves with the Sonics. So in order to keep this franchise going and all their records, like Gary Payton and Sean Kemp and Spencer Haywood and their Sonics records, essentially like moved to Oklahoma City now.
Mm-hmm.
Like if you look back in the history of Oklahoma City, they would count the Sonics as like the same franchise.
Yeah.
This is something you've talked about often with like franchises and players and people moving city to city. How much connection do people even have to them because they can go anywhere?
One of the big conversation topics that comes up a lot is more specifically about fandom and like people who are such ardent fans that they have like an emotional investment in a team or a specific player or group of players. And especially nowadays, it seems like players are moving around so much that I'm like, I mean, how much can you really
how much
love
do you...
someone if you know you might lose them?
Yeah, Aaron Rodgers in Green Bay. I'm going to play a little clip that sort of echoes the distaste with the shared history. Mm. And this is Jeff Van Gundy, the announcer for the NBA. More recently...
Sorry, there's been a lot of names of men.
Yeah. So Jeff Van Gundy, actually, I think he just got fired by ESPN and is going to be going somewhere else to do reporting. But Jeff Van Gundy talks during a game about this shared history thing, and he sort of rants against it in a funny way.
When they were Seattle,
stop.
14 for 14.
Stop putting Seattle and the Supersonics with the Oklahoma City Thunder. It's different teams. I don't want to hear about this anymore. They got their team taken away, and now you're going to bring it up and just put salt on the wound?
Will you stop yelling at me?
No! Stop with this franchise. It's not the franchise.
All right, he's got the Thunder record. The Thunder record is 9-9. Now do you feel better?
I feel better now. And when Commissioner Silver comes in, we need to get a team back in Seattle. ASAP. I don't care if it's an expansion team, it's some other team that's not supporting their team. But to lose, I mean, I can't. Why do you keep saying that?
Well, as long as Nick Collison and Durant, who played there, they've kept, that's what they've decided, to keep the franchise records a part of it. So when you ask...
Does that make any sense to you?
No, I agree, and actually, and it bothers me that I say this, but I see what you're saying.
You think Clay Bennett, the owner, saying, hey, let's make sure Seattle... What do you think, Seattle, like Oklahoma City Thunder is rooting for the Seattle Seahawks this week?
You know, a good question would be, we're in the final minute of the third, is how many Seattle Supersonic fans have stayed with it and this is still their team that they're passionate about, watch every night?
Zero.
No, I don't think it's zero, but I think it's very, very low.
Think about it. They've had Kevin Durant. They've had 15 years of greatness taken out from under them.
Man, you do not want to get Jeff Van Gundy riled up, I guess.
No. That's actually kind of a recurring thing. He gets going. Yeah.
I love when you can totally hear that, like, the two people who are supposed to be commentating are having a hard time getting on the same page and are therefore not actually commentating and are just in an awkward argument that you're listening to.
Sometimes those go on for an entire quarter. All right. So we're near the end here. And as Jeff Van Gundy mentioned there, he said if the league gets new teams, they should definitely go back to Seattle. That is sort of seen as the consensus idea because, as we sort of talked about earlier, Seattle now has a ton of money, tech money and stuff, and they actually just built a stadium for the Seattle Kraken. That,
the
much
hockey
like
team,
a lot of arenas can double very easily as a basketball arena. It's super state-of-the-art.
Did you guys know that at the United Center and other places, the ice is under the basketball court?
Yes, this was something that blew your mind.
It did blow my mind. I was like, I don't know. I wasn't thinking about sports. And so I was like, wait a minute. They're playing basketball in the same place they played hockey last night?
How they do that?
Did they refreeze the ice?
But yeah, that's the plan.
They just put it over the ice. And then I turned to Jim and I was like, someone should do like a time-lapse video of them changing over from the ice to the court. And Jim's like,
That's like a genre of video on the internet. Like an entire world is
just
that.
I'm just saying, I'm impressed by it.
And so I'm going to leave us with this final clip, and this is Gary Payton about rejoining the Sonics if they were to come back.
Now?
As a coach.
Oh.
This is on Draymond Green's podcast.
Would you be into coaching Seattle Supersonics franchise or front office of that franchise?
Yes, very much, Draymond. I would love to go back to Seattle and give them fans what they deserve. They should have never lost a team in the first place. Just bad ownership that was happening during a time where it went down. As soon as I got traded, that ownership took that team to a low, a very, very bad low. And then it happens, you know. But you know, you got to think about, I never played for Oklahoma. So why would I give the fans any kind of opportunity to go in there and say, and why my name rap and your Raptors where I never played at? That's nothing that I would want to do. Mm-hmm. Seattle is what I'm about. Seattle made me. They made me for 13 seasons who I am. They made me a Hall of Famer. You know, they made me a top 75. They made me that type of person. So I would never disrespect Seattle in no kind of way of doing that to the fans. So if and when it does come back, and I know it will, yes, I'm gonna be a part of that organization to keep that going and keep the people going and get our basketball back. Like you said, Draymond, that is a great city, a beautiful city. I still got businesses out in Seattle. You know, I got restaurants out there. So I'm very happy. I'm there all the time, and I'm looking to move back. I want to move back.
It is a cool city. I have been for work. It is a cool city.
You didn't learn about the sports teams, but you've been for work.
I learned from Frasier about the sports teams, but I have been for work, and it is a very lovely city, and I do hope they get a team back. And I know I literally just said, like, when people get obsessed with players and, like, they move around, but, like, I do love how loyal certain players are to their cities.
Mm-hmm.
Because I do think that, like, when you have a player like that, that is kind of a special relationship where the fans do feel like a parasocial connection.
Yep.
So I do think that's cool that Gary Payton's like, do not put my jersey in Oklahoma City. I did not play there. I do not want it there.
Yep. Yep. I really respect it.
Mm-hmm.
And I look forward to the day where Gary Payton is like an assistant coach.
That would be really fun.
The Seattle Supersonics again. And
I love
we get
that.
To celebrate that. And we will celebrate that here on this podcast. When and if it happens. Andi, as we wrap up here, how would you tell the story of the Sonics getting stolen from Seattle other than a documentary called Sonics Gate?
I was going to say like an HBO series because it has a lot of succession elements to
yep.
it. It's a lot of... Because there's things that I don't like about it in the same way that I initially didn't like Succession, where I'm like, it's just a bunch of old white men that are like doing deals and like there's drama about the deals. But because I'm not a business person, I don't really understand the deal. But there is a lot of like drama and passion behind it.
Is there sort of a Greg character who plays Squatch?
Yes.
The mascot?
Yes, 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 yes.
And is also trying to like get in... deeper with
yes
someone.
100% yeah. And in my HBO series, David Stern and Clay Bennett kiss at least once. No, it's like an HBO series, I would assume. Maybe just a mini series, but it's a mini series that like it ends after one season because it's literally all that happened
yeah.
in history. But then everyone liked it. And so you're like, they got renewed for a season two. And you're like, what the hell is season two going to be about?
All right. Well, Andi, thank you for indulging me and going along for the ride again with the long tale of the Sonics losing their team to Oklahoma City.
It was a very enjoyable tale. And I just want to say that the original Frasier with Niles is Frasier. And I do not respect this new Frasier reboot that is happening.
Reboot?
Yeah. They're putting out a reboot, but like none of the other actors on Frasier who actually made it good, like signed on to do it or they're dead.
All right. Thank you so much for listening to another episode of Sports Kid Drama Kid. Like we said up top, you know, feel free to follow the show on the podcast apps, on social media, TikTok, Instagram.
Leave a review. Tell your friends.
And we're looking forward to the next dachshund mascot.
Oh, that was amazing. Okay. Bye.
Bye. Do